Hello, this is Dr. Corenman. We're going to talk about inflammatory autoimmune, infectious diseases, and chronic pain and mimics of low back pain and leg pain. These are essentially neurologic diseases or chronic pain diseases that we'll discuss. Again, my favorite comment was from the physician, the famous Dr. Osler. You find what you know and you see what you look for. If you don't understand that something can happen and you don't know that a condition can occur, you won't look for it. I think this quote's very valuable. We're going to start with retroperitoneal pain referral to the lower back. These are structures, organs essentially, in the retroperitoneal area that will refer pain to the lower back. Embryologically, these structures are all supplied by similar nerve endings as found in the lumbar spine. It's thought that there's possible feedback from the afferent autonomics that goes through the same tract as the somatic sensory system. This is why you get referral pain into the lower back. The retroperitoneal structures, of course, are the abdominal aorta, the kidneys, the pancreas, the gallbladder, the urinary bladder, the ovaries, and the uterus. The quality of pain can very commonly be identified by what structure is affected. Kidneys normally will cause a unilateral costovertebral pain and tenderness. If you percuss the area right below the lowest unilateral rib, you can get significant reproduction of pain. Endometriosis and ovarian cysts, of course, are cyclical pain that are associated with the patient's period. Pelvic inflammatory diseases are not cyclical. There is something called the hanging chandelier sign. The cervix is so tender that the patient has severe pain with any palpation of this. Topic pregnancy, of course, is a surgical emergency. You need a good history, normally 7 weeks after the last period, and the patient should have a prior pelvic inflammatory disease causing scarring of the fallopian tubes. Diverticulitis commonly can cause a steady type of abdominal pain. Cancer of bone or organ can cause different types of pain, normally night pain, and gallbladder is a right-sided pain after a fatty meal. The anatomy of the nerve is relatively simple. You have the cell body with the nucleus that produces many of the substances necessary to, quote, run the nerve, unquote. You have the myelin sheath and many higher order nerves. These are Schwann cells in the peripheral nervous system and oligodendrocytes in the central nervous system. The speed of conduction of the nerve is increased by something called aphaptic conduction, where the signal jumps from the node of Ranvier to the next node. And this is, as you can see, part of the myelin sheath where we have the Schwann cell that is surrounding the nerve and the node of Ranvier, the exposed nerve in between. You have actually jumping from one node to the next, which increases conduction significantly. The synapse is the area where you communicate either with the next nerve or with the muscle. There are synaptic vesicles that contain the neurotransmitter. These are made in the nucleus and then delve down through the cell body and then through the actual dendrite and the axon. There's a presynaptic membrane, and these will be released. There are ligand-gated ion channels, which will allow sodium and potassium to flow in and change the voltage of the nerve, possibly reaching the action potential. A history and physical examination is one of the cores to determine what the neurologic problem is. Upper motor neuron lesion symptoms are imbalance, paresthesias in a non-dermatomal pattern, Lermitte's, problems with fine motor skills, possible bowel and bladder involvement. Upper motor neuron lesion signs are hyperreflexia, release signs such as Hoffman's and inverted radial reflex, and incoordination. Lower motor neuron lesion signs are weakness, reflex deficit, and sensory loss. Symptoms, of course, of motor neuron lesions in the lower aspect are pain, paresthesias, and weakness. Sensation can be increased, decreased, or altered. Allodynia and hyperalgesias are two of the common altered sensations. Of course, you check motor strength, reflexes, endurance, fatigue, and also check for depression. Reactive depression is not uncommon in patients with significant pain. One of my favorite quotes other than Osler's is Voltaire's quote, "The lower back is at the crossroads where the psyche meets the soma, and there's no place truer than in the lumbar spine where low back pain can really cause significant psyche issues." Pain perception with depression becomes amplified, and this is noted to be chemically a depletion of serotonin neurotransmitters. The treatment many times can be an SSRI, and remember the four signs of depression: insomnia, anhedonia, irritability, and lethargy. These are now specific diseases. Multiple sclerosis is an autoimmune disease. The body will produce antibodies against the myelin sheath. It's noted to be greater in females than males in a 2-to-1 ratio, and onset typically is 20 to 40 years of age. The actual problem is attack and destruction of the myelin sheath, and this creates a conduction block, as you can see in the diagram to the right. Common symptoms are a unilateral vision loss, double vision or diplopia, paresthesias of the upper or lower extremities, fatigue, dizziness, and incoordination. The type of multiple sclerosis could be mild or progressive. It is interestingly found more commonly in light-skinned Northern Europeans. Physical exam will note upper motor neuron findings, such as motor blocks and sensory disturbances. Polio, thank goodness, is not seen much anymore, but is still around. It's an infectious viral disease that attacks the anterior horn cells in the spinal cord and brain. If it attacks in the brain, it's called bulbar polio. Diaphragm paralysis can be fatal, and the old iron lungs back in the 30s were quite common. A vaccine confers immunity, as this viral coat doesn't change, unlike in HIV. Paralysis of muscles is associated with, obviously, the nerve cell damage in the anterior horns. Tabes dorsalis is not seen commonly. This is essentially the last part of syphilis, the third stage. Of course, syphilis is a sexually transmitted spirochete bacteria. Normally, you see certain symptoms, and the patient will receive antibiotics immediately, and the disease is cured. However, if the initial stages are not noticed, and the patient advances to secondary and especially tertiary syphilis, this is where we get the neurologic damage. The tertiary form is associated with damage to the posterior columns of the spinal cord, the gracile and cuneate tracts, which are responsible for proprioception. So with damage of those tracts, the symptoms are instability with gait. Patients will say they walk with a drunken gait. And of course, the cause is an inflammatory destruction of the neurons, which causes a temporarily increased output of the brain. And there are stories in the Middle Ages of Middle Age geniuses, and these gentlemen have brilliant discoveries before they lead into insanity. The disease amyotrophic lateral sclerosis is also called Lou Gehrig's disease. It's a disease of only the peripheral motor nerve cells. Therefore, there's no sensory involvement, and it is a painless disease. Somebody who has pain associated with weakness typically does not have Lou Gehrig's disease. The symptoms are loss of strength and weakness, as well as clumsiness. One of the hallmarks of this particular disease is fasciculations, or non-purposeful twitching. This does differentiate from other types of neurologic diseases. The disease advances, lead to loss of speaking, swallowing, and then breathing, and the median survival for this illness is 18 months.